toch in het Engels. Ik denk dat dat geen probleem is. Okay. Welcome to everyone to the expert class Fire Safety Engineering Next Generation 2021 by the Foundation Fellow FSE, the Association of Dutch Fire Safety Consultants, VVBA, and IFV Fire Service Academy. So a kind of cooperation. And that's because we combine this expert class with the nominations of the best master or bachelor thesis in fire safety engineering. And that's also the main part of the program. The second part of this program, well, there are really a lot of participants in the master thesis contest. And some of them want to give you a short presentation, a kind of pitch. And that those pitches are after the break in the second part of the program. And yeah, with really a lot of different and very actual topics. So really nice to follow them, I think. I am Ruud van Herpen. I am a fellow fire safety engineering at the Eindhoven University of Technology. And I'm also a fire safety consultant. A fellow is a kind of professor from outside the university. And the meaning of that is to connect the academic world of the university with the engineering world outside the university. And I think I'm perfect for that because one leg is in the academic world and the other leg is in the engineering world. I'm a senior consultant at NIMAN. And then a fellow at the University of Eindhoven. The foundation is sponsored by several parties, industry associations, companies in the construction industry, but also suppliers of active and passive fire protection systems, etc. For more information, take a look at the website. fellowfse.nl, and then you see what kind of parties are in that foundation and what we try to achieve with the foundation. The main goal is to achieve sustainable fire safety with project specific characteristics. So that means that we're really trying to do a performance based approach. Because that is basically fire safety engineering, using a performance-based approach and taking into account all different boundary conditions with their own uncertainties. That means a lot of simulations, simulation of fire development, simulation of response to fire for both building constructions and building occupants, etc. So a very nice topics also for students in master research to gain knowledge on in that field. Okay, the program this afternoon is well, first me with a short introduction and also a short overview of the research that we're doing in Eindhoven and the actual topics that are also related to the building industry nowadays. Then the second presenter is Liebe de Witte, senior researcher at the Fire Service Academy. He will tell you a little bit, I think, about Oudewater, your experiments 2 years ago, almost 2 years ago, of the Fire Service Academy. In the break we combine with the poster session. So when you're drinking coffee or tea or whatever, you can also see the posters of the participants in the thesis contest. And then the second part, you see, we have 10-minute pitches of several participants in that contest. And then again, a break with poster session. And in the end, David den Boer from the VVBA, the Dutch Association of Fire Safety Consultants, will give you the nominations and the three nominees. They can also attend the Fire Safety and Science Conference of IFV Dutch Service Academy this summer in June, and then the winner will be announced. So what I want you to show is that we are facing new risk because boundary conditions are changing. Boundary conditions are changing because of different different buildings, higher insulation levels, zero energy buildings, etc. But also because the building occupant is growing older in Holland. But I think that is in all Western European countries the same. We are dealing with an aging population, and an aging population that might have some consequences for the self-reliance of the building occupants. Okay, what boundary conditions are we talking about when we're using a project-specific approach? That means that we have to know something about the building, we have to know something about the possibility of fire and the fuel, and we have to know something about the building occupant. So we're talking about building characteristics, fire characteristics, and human characteristics. This is a very popular figure where you see the three assemblies of characteristics. And building characteristics, you have to think about the building envelope as insulation level, the accumulation of heat, air tightness, material properties, maybe also combustible material in the building envelope, compartmentation for fire and smoke, how reliable is that compartmentation, and the same goes for the load-bearing structure. Is it possible to keep the building intact during a fire? Building services, and the fire service, but the fire service is maybe more related to human characteristics, I think. Fire characteristics. Yeah, then we're talking about type of fuel. That's of course related to building and user both, because part of the fuel load is not related to the building, but is what we call variable fuel load. So that's a fire load that's related to the user. There are all kinds of ignition sources. Think about new techniques like PV panels, like heat recovery systems, etc. Of course, very useful in normal use, but you can imagine that we add ignition sources to the ignition sources that are already there in compartments or in buildings. And also, the location of the source. Are we talking about an ignition source in a fire compartment or an ignition source in the escape route or maybe outside or in the building envelope even? Everything is possible. And I think in human characteristics, most interesting now is, are the building occupants, are they self-reliant or are they less self-reliant? Although maybe for normal use that can be self-reliant, but in normal conditions, but in case of fire, in fire conditions, that could be completely different. Okay, some examples of building characteristics. You see here, what you see here, especially is the building envelope. Energy transition that we do for existing buildings. That means that we construct a new building envelope at the outside of the existing building envelope. So a new facade against the existing facade. Maybe adding combustible material because it has to be lightweight material. So insulation material, in a lot of cases, we're talking about combustible insulation. Cladding material, and also the air tightness of the building envelope becomes different compared to the existing, to the old building. We in new buildings, we also use new material, new construction materials, like CLT, cross-laminated timber, for instance, or organic insulation material. What you see in the picture most right is a fire in a dwelling made of, what I call straw with loam and plaster. So very combustible building envelope and very hard to suppress that fire. Very, very, very difficult. So different fire scenarios, different fire loads, and that means different risks. fire characteristics. Well, here you see three pictures. The left picture is of the Notre Dame. There is that is a wooden structure, a timber structure in the roof. And that is what we call the permanent fire load. The same goes for CLT constructions. That is the permanent fire load, the fire load that's related to the building, the building construction or the building envelope. And the most right picture is the variable fire load, the fire load caused by furnishment inside, in this case, inside the dwelling, inside the residential function. That fire load is always sensitive to fashion. So you see that we are dealing with uncertainties when it comes to fire characteristics. We don't know exactly what the fire load is. We don't know exactly what the rate of heat release is per unit area. And we don't know exactly how fast the fire development will be. So there are a lot of uncertainties in that. And yeah, I think human characteristics, yeah, of course, the human behavior, that there are also very a lot of uncertainties in how they behave. We like to calculate evacuation or simulate evacuation based on group characteristics, the characteristics of a group of building occupants. But in fact, we are dealing with individuals with their own. With their own mind and with their own body, and some of them are very able to evacuate and can also evacuate very rapidly, but others are not able to evacuate anymore. And if there isn't any help for evacuation, then still we can have self-reliant building occupants. And when we're talking about normal conditions, they can do shoppings by internet, they can buy healthcare. For their own health, but in case of fire, there isn't any help. So then they need to be really self-reliant, and that self-reliant building occupants might be less self-reliant, not self-evacuating in case of fire. So the changing boundary conditions that we are facing nowadays are, I think, related to energy transition, zero energy buildings. That means related to the building envelope and building constructions and the ignition sources in new buildings. On the other hand, related to the aging population, not only the building residents, but I think in all other building functions too, we have to deal with elderly building occupants that might be less self-reliant in case of fire. And so then you can ask yourself, is an evacuation concept in those buildings, is that still a safe concept? Or do we have to think about other concepts than evacuation? Okay, I have then some examples of what you see here. This looks like a very traditional residential building, so only ground level dwellings in this case, separated by a compartment wall. But that isn't true. It looks like we are facing brickwork, but this is after renovation. And what you see here is not brickwork, but are what you could say brick slips on an EPS insulation panel. So that's a new facade attached to the old facade, to the existing facade. We are adding combustible material in the facade compared to the original situation. And not only combustible material, there is also a cavity between the new facade and the old and the existing facade. Well, you can see that means that we can have a fire development in the facade, in the building envelope, where we didn't have that risk in the original situation. For the roof, that's more or less the same. That's also a new envelope attached to the old roof, to the existing roof. In this case, you can't see that very, very clearly on the picture, but in this case, we are talking about integrated PV panels in the roof. And we also, if you look very, very carefully, you see that next to the front door, there is a kind of closet. And that's an energy module. That means that there, is the heat pump, heat recovery system for ventilation, the transformer of the PV panels, that's not inside the dwelling, that is put in that energy closet, again, attached to the facade of that dwelling. And so that means that we also have completely different fire scenarios compared to the old situation. For new residential buildings, CLT is becoming a very popular construction material. In residential buildings, the construction of the separation constructions are both the load-bearing elements, and so the compartment walls are load-bearing walls. The compartment floors are load-bearing floors, so that is a combination of separation construction and load-bearing elements. And if we build that in CLT, you can imagine that if the CLT is not protected, is not isolated from the compartment, that it's also fire load to the compartment. So what I did is a very simple simulation based on a natural fire concept, where I added the permanent fire load caused by CLT to the variable fire load inside a dwelling, an apartment in this case, a very small apartment, about 10 by 7 meters, like that. And then see what happens in that apartment in case of fire, in case of a natural fire. And that's what you see in those two graphs. In those two graphs, you see the temperature development based on what we call a natural fire scenario. The left graph is the traditional dwelling, and the right graph is a residential function in CLT. And I can't see colors, so that is a problem now because I cannot indicate to you what line you have to look. But the line, you see two lines that are where you see the developing fire at a low temperature, and they don't see what you're pointing. So Is the red line is the natural fire line?
Yes.
The red line is a natural fire scenario, and the blue line, I think that's blue then, the other line, is the standard fire curve. So you have to compare the red lines of the left graph and the right graph with each other. Left is the traditional dwelling, and right is the CLT dwelling. And you see then a maximum temperature in the traditional dwelling of, almost 1,000 degrees Celsius, and you see that maximum temperature is much higher in the CLT apartment. And when you translate this what I call thermal load in a standard fire curve, and that is the blue line, then you see that also the standard fire curve, that's a kind of equivalent fire curve, equivalent fire duration according to the standard fire curve, you see that equivalent fire duration is also increasing a lot. I don't know if you can see the numbers on the horizontal axis, but I can't see them, so I don't know exactly how much longer, but I think in the left graph we are talking about less than an hour, of almost an hour standard fire curve, and in the right graph it's much more than 1 hour standard fire curve, and that's the thermal load. So that's good. It's good to see what, and when we then go to a prescriptive-based approach, let's say to our building code. In a building code, in new buildings, we have 60 minutes separation construction, 60 minutes fire-resistant separation construction between compartments. And that 60 minutes is according to the standard fire curve. Well, you see in this two graphs that the left graph, the traditional dwelling, the thermal load is less than the thermal resistance, the fire resistance of the wall. So that's good. That means that there is a real large high probability that the compartment wall can resist the fire. But in the right graph, you see that the thermal load is much higher than the fire resistance of the wall. So that means that the failure probability will be much higher too. And that I tried to make clear in this graph. This is a cumulative distribution probability of the thermal load. And here, I think it's again blue and white and red. The blue dotted line is the traditional dwelling, where you can see that 60 minutes fire resistance, yeah, has a probability of a reliability in this case of, well, let's say 65%, something like that. 65% reliable, a 60-minute fire-resistant wall. But a 60-minute fire-resistant wall in a CLT apartment is less than 10% reliable. So that means that the failure probability of that wall is higher than 90%. So a burn-down scenario of a CLT building is very likely, and the probability of a burn down scenario is higher than the probability is in a traditional concept. So that's something good to realize, because maybe that burn down scenario is acceptable because personal safety of the building occupants and safety of the neighboring plots might be no issue, might be all guaranteed. But then still, you can think, well, we are creating a building in CLT because that's good for sustainability, but that building is not fire resilient. We need to do something to create a fire resilient building in that case. Okay, another problem is, I already mentioned the air tightness of the external separation construction. If the air tightness if a construction is very airtight, you can imagine that in case of a developing fire, the overpressure will also be increase a lot, and that's because the expanding gases they are all remain inside the compartment because of the air tightness. That's a problem in case of a residential function with a front door, because then it's very 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 difficult to open the front door during the evacuation phase. And on the other hand, residential buildings, multi-story buildings, it might be a problem because the overpressure, that's basically the engine of the internal smoke propagation. So when the external separation construction is very airtight, the internal smoke propagation is much faster than when the separation construction is less airtight. So we also need to think about something like pressure relief in that case. Maybe we can use a sprinkler or water mist system to reduce the fire development. Maybe we can think about the ventilation system to reduce the overpressure. But I think we need to do something about that. Overpressure and internal smoke propagation is also very important when you think about other concepts than the evacuation concept. And when we have building residents, building occupants that are not able to evacuate, and there is no internal organization, there is no help for evacuation, then there is no other option than to use a stay-in-place concept. But that means that you have to be sure that in the compartments where there is no fire, that in those compartments, you are safe during the whole fire scenario. Safe for fire, but also safe for smoke. And especially smoke, the internal smoke propagation, that is then the problem. And that's something that Liebel will show you in his presentation a bit more about. So then I come to the consequences of energy transition and an aging population. The research that I did and I showed you some results are all results from student research. So that is really a lot of topic for students to do their master thesis. Let's say kind of preliminary conclusions, consequences. When we use combustible material in construction and combustible material that could be, let's say, combustible insulation material in case of a new building envelope attached to the old, to the existing building envelope. But that could also be CLT in the building construction, in new buildings. We need to isolate that combustible material from the compartments. That means we need protection of the construction material on both sides, not only at the inside, but also at the outside, also at the facade. The facade is also very important to because it could be it could create a shortcut over fire compartmentation. When we have a facade fire, then all compartments behind those facade are threatened by the fire. So that's something that you want to prevent. That's something that you don't want. So prevent a shortcut of fire compartmentation, then the detailing of the adjoining constructions, the detailing of how does a facade, how is it attached to a fire compartment wall or a fire compartment floor, that's very important. And that's also very difficult, because there, the only thing we have is expert judgments. There are no standards for how to make those joints safe. If you're creating a very airtight building envelope, we also have to pay attention to the airtightness of internal constructions, especially the airtightness of separation constructions between compartments or fire compartments. And we have to think about pressure relief provisions. As I already mentioned, that could be the ventilation system. The results now are not very promising. The air leakage path through ventilation ducts is very small, maybe because maybe we can create in that air leakage path also some kind of shortcut that could be also nice for a student to do some research on, because that would help really a lot for the internal smoke propagation if we can decrease the overpressure in the fire compartment. A sprinkler could help in that case too, because with a sprinkler we reduce the fire development, and therefore we can also reduce the provisions on the building envelope and building constructions. Then the stay in place concept, I think that is more future proof than the evacuation concept, although at this moment there is still a high failure probability of a stay in place concept, so we really need to improve that concept a lot. But in many cases it's the only option. If building occupants are not able to evacuate, the only thing you can do is applying a stay in place concept to make sure that in the safe compartments that the building occupants are safe there during the whole fire scenario. A nice thing about the stay in place concept means that we have to more reliable fire compartmentation, more reliable smoke compartmentation. And if we're doing so, we also create a more fire resilient building, and fire resilience is a sustainability aspect. And so that is a nice combination in that here, personal safety and fire resilience goes hand by hand. And so that's a nice combination. Okay, so then I came to the end of my part or my presentation. You can find some student research and some thesis on the fellow website, fellowfsc.nl, in case of ideas, in case of questions. You're always welcome to email me. So you find also my email address on this slide. And okay, for me, that will be all. And I think then I hand over to Liebe.